Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathashala in Food and Nutrition. I am Dr. Vasantha Muthuswamy, formerly with the Indian Council of Medical Research. You would have already seen the part 1 of ethics in clinical research. As you all know, clinical research is research with either human beings, human biological material or human data. All these constitute clinical research because these are involving the human beings, either themselves or their data or their biological samples. When you look at the research in nutrition, it is about research about food or diet as related to health of the people. This research, you know, can be either basic research or the applied research. Basic research can be just laboratory animal studies or in vitro studies in the lab, for which you have the guidelines for the animal experimentation. But as far as the applied research on human being is concerned, which is the clinical research, although the basic principles which you have heard in the earlier lecture are known and those have to be followed, but when it comes to the specific type of study which you are doing, there are certain minor modifications, variations and concerns which one has to address. So what are the kind of studies which you may do as a student in food and nutrition? You can do clinical trials. You can use a food product which you can give to number of the people and see what is the effect of on each one. It can be a clinical trial. You can just do an epidemiological research, go to the community, ask them questions about to know about their various conditions regarding their nutritional status, their nutritional disorders or regarding the diet which they are taking. So these are called the epidemiological studies where you collect information or you can find out what's happening. You can also participate in public health research. There are a lot of national programs are there in the nutrition. These programs are implemented. At times you may be involved by those people to or the government or by the community to go into the community and see that what is the effect of these public health programs in those people who are living in the community. So these are called the public health research. You can be involved in that where you come across a huge number of people. Then there are certain socio-behavioral research. You want to know why certain group of people avoid certain food. Why certain kind of people like something which they may not like something. What is the reason behind it? Is the reason is because of individual likes and dislikes? Or is the reason is because their religion tells them something? So there are a lot of socio-behavioral issues are there which you would like to know, because if you want to plan something for a community, you must understand what is their information behind it, what is their interest behind it, what are the sentiments, only then you can do that. So you can do socio-behavioral research. Then of course there are a lot of times you collect blood or tissue samples from them, you put it in your lab, and after some time you want to, some new tests have come up which you have learnt now and which you think will give you more information. So you go to this what is called biobanks where these tissues and materials are stored. You can take out samples from them and do some research. You may not go directly to the individuals to ask them questions or know what's happening, but you just use their materials. There are certain procedures. Similarly, there is a lot of information is available which is already collected, from which you want to do a reanalysis, and then which is called the data sets. You have heard last time that in any research, if you want to protect the participants, research participants, the public, the twin pillars of protection are two components. One is an independent review by an ethics committee or an institutional review board, and the other one is the informed consent process from the participants. It is said that if these two are taken care of during the conduct of a research, you are protecting the rights and welfare of the human participants who are participating. So today what we are going to do is just look at these two issues in a detailed way to know what do we mean by this informed consent process, what do we mean by the independent review, and what's happening in the country at the current level. Now if you want to look at the ethical issues, because this whole talk is on ethical issues. If you want to look at the ethical issues, it's not that you submit a protocol to your ethics committee and it's ethics committee's responsibility to see that what is right or wrong in your protocol. You have to start thinking about it at the time of protocol development itself. The ethics component of your protocol has to be thought by you, not by your ethics committee. So what do you do? Depending on the type of study which you are doing and the study design, the issues will be different. If it is an observational study where you are not going to directly give anything to individuals, you are just wanting to see what's happening, your requirements are different. If it is an interventional study where you are going to give some component to them as an intervention, naturally the requirements are different. So it all depends on the study design. So what you will have to do is, yes, you need a human participants for your research. It can be individuals themselves, or it can be a whole community if you want to know what's happening in a particular community. So you have to go to the community, meet large number of people, hundreds of people, sometimes maybe even much more. So you have to deal with the community. So in that case, what are their requirements? You may be, as I said earlier, you may just require their biological samples. You don't have to go to the individuals at all. Already collected sample is enough. You want to do some new tests, come out with the new knowledge. And then, of course, biological data. You have already done a study. You have collected hundreds of information. Now you want to do a secondary analysis with that information. Again, you don't have to go back to those patients or volunteers. You don't go back to anybody. In your own department, in your own laboratory, you're going to sit with the data you have collected. You want to do a secondary analysis to see that by doing various analysis, are you going to come out with a new information? So depending on that, again, your ethical issues will be different if you're dealing directly with the human beings or you're not directly dealing with the human beings. So what you have to do is, when you develop a protocol, depending on the type of study and the study design, you have to think that what can be the anticipated ethical issues in the particular study. And then you have to write in the protocol, these issues may be there, and if these issues are there, how do you plan to resolve them? How do you tackle them? How do you handle those issues? It has to be written down in your protocol, and then you have to also say that what are the informed consent procedures you are going to plan. Are you going to the individuals and take consent? Are you going to the community leaders and you will take consent? Are you going to take a written consent, a verbal consent? Are you going to do audio-visual consent? There are various methods of taking consent. And there are also issues that, for example, if you are going to use biological samples and the data, you are not going to go to the individuals at all. You are only going to look at these, and you are not interested in knowing whose sample it is or whose data it is. You are more interested in the information which is there and the information which you are going to now collect. So you can even ask for waiver of consent from your ethics committees. You can say that since directly human beings are not involved and I am not going to look at their names and address or the details, can the ethics committee give me a waiver of consent? So I will not take into consent, but I will do the study. So the ethics committees can see what is the kind of study you are doing, and they may give you permission to do waiver of consent. So you'll have to look at that informed consent. Then what you do, that you submit it to the ethics committee before starting the study. It's not that you have done the study, halfway suddenly you realize, oh, the ethics committee approval is not there, go back and tell them, I have started the study in January, it is July now. Now I want to do the take the approval. Ethics committee will not do that. You are supposed to take the ethics committee approval before initiation of the study. And then, of course, the ethics committee will demand periodic monitoring. So you have to submit annual report to them. You may have to submit your final report, and at times, depending on your study, they may even say submit 6-monthly report. So you'll have to submit 6-monthly report. So these are the procedures which you have to think of while developing the protocol, submitting and getting approval. So the ethical component of any study gets into this at this stage itself. What is an ethics committee? It's a committee which will examine the proposals. They look into the scientific aspects of the proposal as well as the ethical issues which are involved in that. And then they will say that if they give permission, is it enough to protect the safety and the well-being of the participants, or they have to give you additional suggestions so that the safety of the participant will be taken care of. And the composition of the ethics committee, one has to follow the ICMR guidelines. What is given in the guidelines? There should be a chairperson. There can be one or two person from the basic medical science area. There can be one or two medical persons, the clinicians from various other institutes. There has to be a legal expert. We'll look into the legal issues. It can be a lawyer or a retired judge. There has to be a social scientist who will be looking into the social issues, since especially your studies are involving community and the community members. So you have to see that a social scientist in the committee to understand the issues. There can be a philosopher or a religious expert, depending on what is the type of study. And there has to be one lay person who represents the community, because whatever is the community concern, this person can look into that and before giving the approval. So this is the composition. So all committees have all these members definitely in their committee. And the committee will be handled by a member secretary who belongs to that institution. Now, what is the responsibility of these members? they have to give a competent and comprehensive review of proposal. Any proposal which comes, they'll read it, they'll try to understand, and then they'll have to give their opinion. They have to review objectively. They should be free from bias and any external influences. They have to participate in the ethics committee meeting. It's not enough if they read and give their comments and send it. It's now necessary that all the members meet during the committee meeting, sit and physically present and attend the meetings. So they have to participate in the ISC meeting for giving their opinion. Not only that, initial approval, most of the time people take initial approval, forget about the whole thing. No, you can't do that. What is happening during the entire progress of the study till the end has to be monitored by the ethics committee. So you have to submit annual reports or to monitor the ongoing studies. In some studies, there can be some adverse event happening. The participants may have some difficulties. One has to understand what is the kind of difficulties. So one has to keep on reporting all these to the ethics committees. And nowadays it is insisted these ethics committees also can do on-site visits wherever necessary. If you are going to a tribal community for something, and if you think the way you are taking the informed consent to the ethics committee is not happy with that, the ethics committee members can do on-site visit to see what kind of an informed consent you are taking, are you really informing them or not. So the ethics committees have this additional responsibility in the recent years to do on-site visits wherever necessary. The ethics committee members should be aware of the existing guidelines, national, international, and what are the laws which are there. So it becomes important for the member secretary to keep on informing the ethics committee members about the recent changes which is happening in the country as well as in the international scenario. The ethics committee members have to also sign a confidentiality agreement. Whatever being discussed in the meeting, whatever information they get by the project which you are submitting to them, the knowledge which they are gaining, if it is of personal nature with anybody or any community, they can't disclose it outside. So they have to sign a confidentiality agreement. If you are an ethics committee member and if you have your own proposal coming for the committee, yes, you can be there, but then you cannot participate in the review process and the decision making process. You cannot say that no, a person who is a researcher cannot be a member. Can be a member, but then during that their own proposal, when it is discussed for review and decision making, they cannot be present. They have to go out of the room. So these are the basic requirements for the responsibilities of an ethics committee member. Now, many people think that unless there is a human, directly the human beings are involved, you don't have to take ethics committee approval. When you are looking at the biological material or looking at the data, they think what is there, directly patients are not involved. There's no need of taking informed consent. So why should it go to the ethics committee? But the requirement is now anything, well, even if you use plants and cell culture, but which is related to the human research. You are doing a chart review or looking at the data, as I said. You are doing simple studies like taking blood pressure, height, weight. Yeah, as long as somebody is involved, a human being is involved, you have to take the ethics committee's approval. Even simple studies, if you are a physiotherapist and you are doing simple studies related to physiotherapy and you are not a physician, you can't think that you cannot take ethics committee approval, you will have to take it. If you are involved in a study being done by a nurse which is related to the patients, again one has to take ethics committee approval. Of course this is related to more physicians, if there is a case study, if you want to report, you have to take permission. Even studies which are done related to the dead bodies or cadavers, which needs approval of the ethics committee. So you have to have the ethics committee's approval for any study involving, as I said, human beings, their material or their data. So any study other than involving animals related to the human beings, it can be clinical trials, it can be a questionnaire study, we are asking simple questions to people. It can be on, you want to do an educational study, educating patient about your nutritional status, nutritional requirements, if you want to give them. What is the education which you want to impart to the participants or the public has to be noted to the ethics committee. They have to see what is the information you are giving before giving approval for what you have to do. Or if you are using sputum, blood, urine, any body fluid, anything. So any study other than involving animals, because once animals are involved, as you know, it has to go to the Institutional Animal Ethics Committee. All other studies will go to the Institutional Human Ethics Committee for their approval. Now, what is the kind of review the Ethics Committee will do? Is it necessary that all studies have to go, means there is nothing, there is no study which cannot be, which need not go to the Ethics Committee? No, there is also a category called exempt from review. if the study has no has less than minimal risk, there is no risk involved, and you are going to, for example, you have the census data, you want to look at the census data and do some analysis, you are not going to look at anybody's name, address, personal details are not there, you just want to do an analysis. Yes, you do not have to have an ethics committee approval. These can be exempted because you are not looking into any individual's personal data. But then the power to give an exemption for review is also lies with the ethics committee. You cannot decide as a researcher that this study where you are already looking into, say, national nutrition monitoring bureaus are there and their data are always published. So as a student of food and nutrition, you want to look at the data of National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau and then you want to do your own analysis where you are not looking into any individual data. Yes, you can do this study and you need not have to go for any consent here, you need not have to, you may not take the approval. But then that this study will be exempt from review is also permission. So you have to submit to an ethics committee and ask for exempt from review. Okay. So that is a, so the power lies only with them, not with you. The second is there is something called expedited review. If the meeting, the committee meeting is being held once in 2 months or once in 3 months, you want to do a simple study where there's no risk to the patients, you are just going to look at the, as I said, look at the data, you are going to collect the samples and do some study where again there is no individuals are involved. You want to get an early approval from your ethics committee. So what you can do is you can submit it for expedited review where there is a procedure which is given in the ICMR guidelines, how it can be done fast, how a subcommittee of the main committee will go through that and give their approval, and then you can go ahead with that. And then later on the main committee will be involved, informed about it. So this is called the expedited review. The third is the full board review at the main meeting. If the study involves any risk to the participants, or the study is an interventional study, or if the study involves vulnerable populations, then you cannot go for exempt review or expedited review. You have to submit it to the full board whenever it is held. So these are the three types of review which an ethics committee will do. So it all depends on what is the kind of study you want to do. What does the ethics committee do? Ethics committee, does it only look into the ethical issues? They look into the scientific design of the study. They want to see that your qualifications, whether you are qualified to do such studies. What kind of recruitment of research participants you are planning? Your methods are appropriate. Do you have enough procedures for safeguarding the safety of the vulnerable populations if they are used? If you have a community study, what are the community considerations? How are you going to consult the community and take their consent? Are you going to pass on some benefit to the community? In case something happens during and after the research, are you going to take care of their care and protection and have procedures for continuous monitoring of these participants? How will you take informed consent? When you take informed consent, it's just a simple paper you are going to give them, ask them to sign. Are you going to give the information? And what is the kind of information you have given? So the information which you are going to give in the patient or participant information sheet should also be submitted to the ethics committee. So the complete information will be seen. They will look at the written document and they will see that what kind of a consent you have. Only then they will give the approval. There are many times there are issues related to confidentiality. You are going to the community collecting lot of information. Some of the information may be very sensitive, which one person may not like the other person to know, or whatever information coming from that community, they may not like to make it public. But then this information is very important for you, for your study. So what is it which you have to do is, how do you maintain the confidentiality of the information collected? Are you having enough protective mechanisms? And in case something happens, there is a breach of this confidentiality and the information leaks, then what is the kind of your responsibility to protect them? So these are the kind of things which one has to look into from the type of study which you are doing, which the ethics committee will review. So the ethics committee, what they'll do, they have to do a good protocol review. They will look into the objective, design, inclusion, exclusion criteria, what are the scientific tools, sample size, analysis plan. They will look into the risk-benefit ratio. They'll look at whether your science design is ethically sound. And they'll also see that any vulnerable groups are involved, what are the issues, is the conflict of interest is taken care of, how the confidentiality is maintained, the research team is qualified, and are you choosing the right site for doing your study? If you want to do a study in a site where the question which is asked is not relevant, is it going to be give you good results? So these are the things they will. And then you have to submit a form in which all these are issued. And so when they do the review, they have to do a good assessment. Go to the previous one. You have slipped one. Yeah. So So there has to be a good assessment form, and in this assessment form they'll mark all these issues.
Yes.
Then they will look into your informed consent document. They will see that, are you giving full disclosure of information to the participants? What is the kind of compensation which you are planning? What are the responsibilities which you are giving to the participant? What are your own responsibilities? Are you using the simple terms and in a local language which a person or the participant or a community member can understand? If you use hi-fi language in English, a consent form is given and signed, it will not be acceptable. So you have to use a simple local language form which the individual can understand. And this is the responsibility of the lay member of the community who is in the committee to see that whether your consent form is in a simple language which a person can understand. Then are you giving time for the individuals to go through all these things, understand, and they can give their consent. So what is the voluntariness component of this whole process is what the ethics committee will check. So the informed consent form, when you see, it should be in regional language, it should be translated into an understandable language, it should be have adequate information should be there. It should also say that who will administer it, what is the timing of administration, and if the children are used, how will you take the parental consent, and the children are grown up, adolescents, you have to take also the assent of the child. In case necessary, there is some information comes up, you have to go back to the individuals and take a re-consent during the study, whether you have provision for that. Are you aware that in case of children and those who are vulnerable, who are not capable of giving consent on their own, there is a legally acceptable representative who will give consent? Do you know who is that person? And wherever necessary, whether audio-visual recording can be done, especially for vulnerable groups. And the committee will have its own decision making. It's not approval, we should not say approval of the committee, it's decision making by the committee. Where the committee can approve it, committee can disapprove it and reject it. And the committee can also suggest asking you to make some minor modification. The committee can also say, no, you have to do a major changes. If there is a minor change, you can resubmit it for expedited review. If it is a major change and you have to make changes, it will come back to the committee, full board, for the next decision making. So what happens after the approval? The project is approved by the ethics committee. You have to inform the date of initiation, and you have to keep on monitoring to see that whether there are amendments, adverse effects, any changes are there. And if any changes are made, you have to ask for a re-consent from the ethics committees. And finally, after the study is over, you have to submit a final report. So these are the responsibilities of the investigator as far as the ethics committee is concerned. Now let us move on to the next pillar, that's the informed consent process. So what do you do in informed consent process? Why informed consent? As you already heard, informed consent is one of the primary ethical requirement underpinning human research. The principle of autonomy demands that the individuals have a right to decide for themselves whether they want to participate in your research or not. And in the correct conduct and documentation of this process is given in the GCP guideline, that is a good clinical practice guideline, which is actually for the research purposes. So the investigators have to be trained, and the EC members also to be aware of what this whole process is involved. The compliance is given in various international and national documents talk about compliance of the informed consent process. Declaration of Helsinki says that you have to take the informed consent. The Schedule Y of the Drug Controller for Clinical Trials in India demands that you have to have a proper, well-written, informed consent. The ICH-GCP, that's the International Committee on Harmonization, that also says it. The ICMR guidelines under Section 1, General Ethical Issues, informed consent is given as a general requirement, and it is also now in the new guideline. There is a special topic on this. Then US government, so every guideline in the world talks about the informed consent process. So what is this? It will protect the individual's freedom for participation in research, and this is to respect the individual's autonomy for decision making. That they are the ones who can decide what you can do with their body. You cannot take decision who will participate, you have to give them the choice. How should the informed consent be given? Can you force them? Can you tell them, no, you have to sign, it's compulsory, you sign it here? No, you can't do that. You have to give them the information, you have to give them the time to think, and you have to give them allow them to make the decision making and then sign. Because a written informed consent is what is necessary. If they cannot sign, they have to put a thumb impression. Give a thumb impression put by an individual who cannot sign, and then you have to have a witness, who is an impartial witness, also to sign, yes, this has been informed to the individuals. So Declaration Helsinki says, they have made it compulsory, it should be done, and it is a subject's physician's responsibility or the investigator's responsibility to do that. Next. It has to be given voluntarily, you cannot do any compulsion. And the definition is that, so as per the ICH-GCP, It's a process by which the subject voluntarily confirms his or her willingness to participate in a particular trial or a research. After the research, which is relevant, their decision to participate. And informed consent has to be documented by means of written, signed and dated informed consent form. So informed means you give them enough information in a simple language which they understand, and then they give the consent and sign. So it's called the informed consent form. Next. And the document should be available in English in most of the places because the teaching is in the English language. But then it has to be translated in the local vernacular languages. For example, in an institution like All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, where you have patients coming from all over India, and if they have to be recruited into the research, if there are 10 different, 15 different languages, the informed consent is translated. So that each patient belonging to a particular language, they can understand it. So one, you will have two parts. One is the information sheet, which describes all the information. The second is the consent form, where the individuals sign after and indicate their willingness to participate. So the process whole consists of two things. One is the issue of compliance, because the guideline says ethics demands you must take the informed consent signature. The second is that it is a, you give the opportunity to the individual to voluntarily decide. Decision making is with the individuals and not with the investigators. The third in important thing is you give them enough information, adequate information to be disclosed, and they should be made to understand. And then finally, they have to give them the authorization to indication of agreement is that they are signing. And then of course, the whole thing has to be kept confidentially. Okay, the confidence has to be maintained. So the information, how will you information? As I already said, it should be simple, understandable, unambiguous language, non-technical it should be. And you cannot make them waive their legal rights and produce any conflict of interest while taking the informed consent. So especially in a vulnerable, there are guidelines for vulnerable groups and how do you take so that you minimize the risk for them. And a legally authorized or acceptable representative will give consent on their behalf. Now in the ICMR new guidelines, which is now coming up in 2017, there is a special section on vulnerability which lists the entire group of people who are considered vulnerable. So children, women in special situation, mentally, cognitively impaired, tribal population, sexual minorities, persons suffering from stigmatizing a rare disease, those who are terminally ill, those who are economically and socially disadvantaged, and those are institutional individuals, and those who have a lack of power to due to dependency. These are all the people. So students are considered vulnerable. So we have created a video on informed consent and from the Forum for Ethics Review Committees in India, which says seven different situations where the informed consent is given in a wrong way and then in a right way. And this can be used for the teaching purposes in many of the institutions. So if you look into the public health, the epidemiological and social science research with which you are mostly involved, you have to understand that you have to take consent from individuals or a community. So in the community, wherever needed, your community leader's consent will be taken, but you cannot compromise on individual consent. After the community leader, or who is also called the gatekeeper, consent is taken, you have to also take individual consent. It has to be written consent. In some cases, there can be verbal consent, but it has to be properly recorded. Many times, you have to use deception, partially or total, but you have to take ethics committee approval for that. You have to see that post-research benefits goes to the community. And if there are incidental findings, you should know how do you deal with those findings. How do you take ancillary care during the time when the patients or individuals fall sick? And most important in these kind of studies is after your study is over, your results are known, you are supposed to go back to the community and do the debriefing so that they understand what is being done with them. So this comes under the duty to disclosure. You use them, you've done your study, and your results should be taken back to the community, which is called your duty to disclosure. Okay. So this is so in the new ICMR guidelines, you have all these new sections. Once it will be released soon, you will come to know about the general as well as special issues. And this can be, and every researcher in this country is supposed to read the ICMR ethical guidelines so that you understand the issues and the intricacies of each and every type of research. So this is what it's the details about the informed consent process and ethics committees, because just by telling ethics committee approval and informed consent to be taken is not enough. You must understand what does an ethics committee do and what do we actually mean by the informed consent process. If you start doing a research, you will be very successful in doing a ethically well conducted research, which will be appreciated by everybody, which also gives you the satisfaction.